Once there were many trumpeter swans in North America. They lived and flourished in river estuaries and marshlands across much of the continent. By 1930, they were nearly extinct. Today, there are again many trumpeter swans on the west coast of North America. The near extinction and return again of trumpeter swans says much about human psychology and how our attitude towards nature affects the animals of the natural world, and how the creatures of the natural world, in turn, affect our minds and spirits. This is the Reverend Charles Brandt. He is a Catholic priest, an ornithologist, and a wildlife photographer. He has devoted much of his life to the conservation of nature, which he feels is a source of both natural and spiritual wealth for humanity.
It's a wonderful sound, those swans, huh? And, for example, if you're living on a moon, which is pretty desolate, it'd be pretty difficult to have a deep interior spiritual life, because there's nothing there to nourish it or encourage it. But here on the planet Earth, we have all these wondrous things, the trees, the birds, the animals, and they nourish it. Without the swans, without the rivers, and without the sky and the insects, we become impoverished. And we look at often at the natural world as a commodity. And for example, the feathers here, this is turning something quite beautiful in the natural world into a commodity for our own personal benefit, to make money. It's stuff. We want to buy stuff. And we go anywhere to get this stuff. We even go to our swans and all their beauty and their naturalness. And create stuff to sell as a commodity rather than something that will have a benign presence.
A passing motorist sees a huge flock of seagulls resting in the parking lot of a shopping mall. So what does he do? This is clearly a mean-spirited act by a human being who sees no value in the creatures of the natural world. They are mere objects to be used or abused at will. This relationship is a kind of spiritual impoverishment.
What happens in the outer world happens also in the inner world. We become impoverished. If the outer world becomes impoverished, then that affects our imagination, our spirituality, our intellect. And we call that soul loss. We're actually, in a sense, losing our soul. And, without the soaring birds, the eagles, without the pileated woodpeckers on my property, or the ravens nesting, and sound of the river, and the skies, and the insects, we become impoverished. We become less than human.
Rather than regarding animals as commodities, other cultures have seen the relationship between human beings and animals as sacred. In India, Sarasvati, the goddess of poetry and speech, rides a swan. The union of the goddess and the swan expresses the balance of nature and spirit that has been the goal of many cultures. In Greek mythology, the supreme god Zeus is also portrayed as a swan. The story of Leda and the swan expresses humanity's need for the natural world in developing our own creativity. We asked Steph Nathan of the Comox Valley Naturalist Society what caused the dramatic decrease in the numbers of trumpeter swans in the late 19th and early 20th centuries.
Hudson Bay and other trappers trapped them for their hides and for their feathers for fashion statements. The hides were made into purses and bags, and the feathers were made into boas and hats. And they were basically trapped out.
Since 1991, members of the Comox Valley Naturalist Society have been counting swans. Naturalists report from 21 separate viewing locations in the valley to ensure a thorough and accurate count. And they meet at the local watering hole to tabulate results.
We had 18 adults and 12 juveniles. And on Dove Creek, we had 78 adults and 20 juveniles.
Their counting is part of a waterfowl management project designed to ensure that trumpeter swans are not endangered again.
13 adults and 19 juveniles.
Oh, thank you. I like it when you write it down, and I know I've got it right. Thank you, John.
Today, there are approximately 25,000 trumpeter swans in North America, and 10% of these winter here in the Comox Valley on Vancouver Island. They arrive in mid-November, and in April, they head back to their breeding grounds in Alaska and the Yukon. With a wingspan of up to 8 feet, trumpeter swans are the largest waterfowl in North America.
Wildness is a quality, and somehow if we can maintain that quality of wildness, for example, the swans, they're, in a sense, they're wild birds. They become a little bit domesticated now because we're always around them and they use our fields to graze on, but they're really wild creatures, and it's that state of wildness that preserves the earth. Just wildness itself, because that's the way that nature is unfolding. That's the dream of the earth, is to have all these creatures that somehow reflect ultimate reality.
Their natural habitat's in the estuary. They eat rhizomes that are in the intertidal zone, and They also eat salmon and spawning rivers and all kinds of other little things under the water.
Why aren't they in the estuaries now?
And
why didn't they stay there?
Because there's an airport in the lower mainland, all the Vancouver and Richmond and Delta, all subdivided and put buildings and airports and people in the estuary. So now the birds had to figure out a different system. And they learned by getting out of the water and walking on the farmer's field that the farmers planted some very nice things.
Farmers being here and providing the good quality food that the swans are able to feed on throughout the winter and allow them to get into good physical condition and go back to the breeding grounds in peak condition obviously helps the population increase. But it also, for the farmers, for some of the farmers, it's a real problem with the amount of crop damage that the swans impose on the farms. And that's where Ducks Unlimited has come in. Since 1991, they've been operating the Comox Valley Swan Management Program, Waterfowl Management Program, and basically learning ways of coexisting with trumpeter swans, moving the swans around so that the damage to single fields on certain farms isn't so great. And we do that by cover crops, so lure crops, winter crops that are annual in nature that the swans can feed on unharassed, and that brings them off of the more valuable perennial forages that the farmers are trying to protect.
We're talking about planting carrots for swans.
Carrots or winter cereals or grass specifically for trumpeter swans to utilize throughout the winter. Trumpeter swans is a great fit, and learning how to coexist with trumpeter swans that were a threatened species, and also an adaptable species, unlike the dodo bird or the dinosaurs, which couldn't adapt to our disturbance or evolution. The trumpeter swans have adapted, and fairly well, or maybe too well for the farmer's point of view, but it's a great story.
Perhaps no other endangered species has made such a remarkable return from near extinction. Their success may be a model for human relationship with other wildlife.
To move from a disruptive influence to benign presence, there are all sort of things we can do, like that's what the environmental groups do. But, you know, we haven't really been succeeding. For example, there's just as much global warming is getting worse. We're losing more species. We're losing our wild salmon and bad mining and bad logging, all these things. So the main thing that works then is to establish this relationship with the natural world, to fall in love with the natural world. And once we do that, then we're going to preserve it through having this sense of wildness, which leads to a preservation of the earth. Okay, I think where do we go from here? That's a question that Thomas Berry answers. And he answers that, he has a book called The Great Work, and that's sort of his life's work, and it's his final statement. I don't think he's written anything since then. All of us have a work to do. I mean, you're a teacher or a cameraman, I'm a bookbinder, practice the contemplative life. So we all have a work. We're teachers, firemen, fishermen. But we also have a great work, which we're all involved in. And the great work is bringing about that transition that I was speaking of, transition from a society that's having a disruptive influence on the earth, that includes all of its creatures, the swans included, having a disruptive influence, making a transition to having a benign presence to the earth. And we make that transition, I think, by experiencing creation with a sense of wonder and delight. Okay.